Is he the man to save Pakistan, or is he too soft on the Taliban? I'll ask Imran Khan. I'm Mehdi Hasan. This week, Hillary Clinton became the official Democratic nominee for president. But will voters on the left come out and back her come the election in November? I'll ask top economist and Bernie Sanders advisor Professor Jeffrey Sachs, who's called her a danger to world peace. But first, to his fans, he's the face of a new, honest, uncorrupt Pakistan. The cricket captain turned political leader. In the eyes of his opponents, he's an apologist for the Taliban at a time when Pakistan is plagued by violence and militancy. This week's headliner from Islamabad, Imran Khan. Imran Khan, thanks for joining me on Upfront. You have suggested that Nawaz Sharif, Pakistani Prime Minister, has lost moral authority, should stand down from office because he has no credibility after his alleged involvement in tax dodging, offshore accounts, the so-called Panama Papers in which he and his family's names appeared. Some would say you're trying to get him removed from office over unproven accusations because you couldn't actually beat him at the ballot box back in 2013.
Well, Mehdi, the issue of Panama Papers or Panama leaks is quite straightforward. That there were offshore companies belonging to Nawaz Sharif's children. They weren't declared by Nawaz Sharif. The companies belonged to his daughters, his daughter, who was a dependent. And these companies bought property, millions of dollars worth in England. So he's implicated in it because he didn't declare the money. He's accused of concealment of assets. He's accused of tax evasion, corruption, and money laundering.
But do you want Nawaz Sharif to stand down? Is it your position is he should stand down from office?
No, we want him to answer. Basically, Article 40 of the Constitution of Pakistan says that the Prime Minister and the Cabinet are answerable to the Parliament in case of breaking the law or abusing taxpayers' money. They're answerable to the Parliament, which is what democracy is. So basically, we're just asking him to give us the answers.
In the wake of the recent failed military coup in Turkey, you said people would celebrate and distribute sweets if there was a military takeover in Pakistan, which prompted the government to accuse you of being shameful, indulging in a conspiracy. The Dawn newspaper accused you of threatening the democratic order, of betraying the constitution of Pakistan. What do you say to them?
Well, Mehdi, in 1999, there was a coup against Nawaz Sharif, who is now again the prime minister. And the sweet shops in Lahore ran out of sweets because everyone was distributing sweets. Now, I was basically comparing the two coups. There was one in Pakistan in 99, Nawaz Sharif as the prime minister, and people distributed sweets. There's one in Turkey where actually the people came out in support of the government. And I was comparing the two. The difference is that when Erdogan came into power, despite all his faults, if you look at the standard of living, you look at the per capita income, you look at the debt of Turkey. I mean, in every way, he's improved the lot of the common man.
But surely you'd accept that in a country like Pakistan, which has had as many military coups as Turkey, almost as many coups as Turkey, isn't it deeply irresponsible and dangerous in a country like Pakistan to even joke about military takeovers, for a politician to even hint at a military takeover?
Mehdi, to be clear, for 20 years, I have struggled for Pakistan's democracy. I started with nothing. I didn't come from a political family. I built a party which is now the biggest party in Pakistan. So I didn't struggle for 20 years to get the army to come in and take over. I mean, the whole struggle is to bring democracy to Pakistan. Basically, my comment was that we want a genuine democracy. We do not want a Hosni Mubarak type of democracy, because Hosni Mubarak also held elections, but there was no democracy. Democracy means where a leader is accountable to the people.
Okay, You've been accused of being not just too close to the military, but also you've been accused of being soft on the Taliban, of being linked to the Taliban. Some of your critics have even dubbed you Taliban Khan, because in the words of the Pakistani journalist Cyril Almeida, you've, quote, mainstreamed extremism. It's an allegation, even in the West, in the outside world, we hear more and more that Imran Khan is soft on the Taliban, that he distinguishes between good and bad Taliban. What's your response to such criticisms?
Firstly, what is the evidence that I'm close to the military? When General Musharraf was in power, when we had General Musharraf, a military dictator in power, I was the only leader, political leader, who was sent to jail. I was his biggest opponent. I was against his military rule, probably, which is why I was the only one sent to jail. All the rest were house arrested. Now, second, Taliban. Most people do not understand the whole Taliban syndrome. The phenomena of Taliban has to be understood that there were no militant Taliban in Pakistan when 9/11 took place. There were no militant Taliban in Pakistan right up till 2004. The militancy started in Pakistan when Pakistan Army went into our tribal areas. The tribal areas of Pakistan are per capita are the most weaponized place on earth. It has more weapons than anywhere else. So when the Pakistan Army went into the tribal areas, collateral damage took place because there were villages that were being bombed, women and children were being killed, and our Taliban was not an ideological movement. The ideological part would be barely 5%. Basically, it was a reaction of Pakistan Army perceived to be going into the tribal areas on behest of the Americans, supposedly to flush Al-Qaeda, which had come in from Afghanistan after Tora Bora. And so we did not have ideological Taliban as a movement.
But a lot of people would say you're very good at analyzing the subject, you're very good at understanding the problem, but you don't condemn it as much as other people. We all agree that the Pakistani Taliban are a product of war, of militancy, of the war on terror, whatever you want to get into the root causes. But ultimately, they are a vicious group that kill civilians, and people like yourself, the critics say, don't condemn them enough.
This is absolute nonsense. It's just not true. All you have to do is look at my statements for the past 10 years. Every bomb attack any human being would condemn, where innocents are being killed.
Do you consider the Taliban to be a terrorist group?
Yes, they are. Anyone who kills innocent people are terrorists. They have killed, and there are 50 different groups. Remember one thing, Mehdi, there are 50 different Taliban groups, or at one point there were, they're less now, but at one point, 50 different groups called themselves Taliban. Amongst them were drug mafia, land mafia, smugglers.
But the main group, the TTP in 2014, asked for you to be a mediator on their behalf in talks with the government. You turned them down, but the fact is that one of the world's most vicious groups picked you to be their go-between with the Pakistani government. Why do you think that is?
So there was an all-parties conference in Pakistan. All the parties decided that there should be a dialogue to make with the one who could be reconciled. So once this was agreed, the government started a dialogue or proceeded to talk to the Taliban for a dialogue. So once that happened, then the request came from Taliban, okay, the ones who they find credible, one of them was me, which of course I refused. And that dialogue was sabotaged by a drone attack. Before the dialogue could start, the head of that Taliban was killed by a drone attack, and that was the end of the talks.
On the ideological front, the former president of Pakistan, Asif Ali Zardari, recently criticized you for your party's decision at a regional level to allocate 300 million rupees, around 3 million US dollars, to the Darul Uloom Haqqaniya, which has been dubbed the University of Jihad because of the number of Taliban fighters who have come through its ranks. Former President Zardari says that your party giving the money is the legitimization of the Taliban and an undermining of Pakistan's fight against the Taliban.
This is Zardari, like so many of the Muslim corrupt rulers, ex-rulers, trying to win Western support by saying, you know, how liberal they are and, you know, how anti-Taliban they are. And this has totally out of context, this whole thing is being said. Now, let me just explain. what is my party's view on madrasas. When you marginalize people, as you're finding in the West, you radicalize them. Marginalization leads to radicalization. So the whole idea was to get the madrasa system into the mainstream so that these children from the poorest background in the madrasas, 2.2 million children, they should be brought into the mainstream so they could also get jobs.
But have you mainstreamed that University of Jihad now? Have you succeeded in mainstreaming it?
Firstly, it's, you know, all the governments, if it was a university for jihad, it should have been shut down. Because, I mean, there was Asif Zardari's government was in power for 5 years. Why didn't he shut it down?
It's not just the Taliban's intolerance that's threatening Pakistan today. You have Ahmadis being persecuted by the state, Shias regularly being targeted and massacred. Would you get rid of the blasphemy laws, for example, which were brought in during the Soviet war and which lead to a lot of minorities, Ahmadis, Christians, getting lynched, being put on trial, being sentenced to death? Would you get rid of those repressive laws?
First of all, the background of blasphemy law is this. That blasphemy law was brought in by the British, not at the time of General Zia, as it's wrongly perceived. The British brought it because when in villages where Hindu, Muslim, Sikhs, Christians were living, easily a riot could take place if someone said something against something bad about someone sacred to one of the religions. So the British brought this blasphemy law. It was actually to prevent there would be legal action against anyone who caused mischief, unfortunately, Mehdi, in the 80s. We got these sectarian groups. First time we saw Shia, Sunni killing each other. We never had this before in Pakistan. Shia and Sunnis lived together before.
But would you, as Prime Minister, repeal those blasphemy laws that are used to target Christians, Ahmadis and others?
Mehdi, it's not the laws. The laws are not a problem. Problem are militant groups in Pakistan. What should happen is we should get rid of the militant groups. If in a village, you're living in a village in Pakistan, unless you fight extremism, and extremism is not going to be fought by laws, extremism has to be fought first by disbanding those groups that are perpetuating this extremism. Whatever you do with the laws, people will be killed. And remember, since we've entered this war on terror, things have got worse.
We had Shehbaz Bhatti, Salman Taseer, leading Pakistani politicians were assassinated when they spoke out against the country's blasphemy laws. A lot of Pakistani politicians would like to speak out against those laws, but they're worried about being killed. They're afraid for their own lives. Are you one of them?
Ever since 9/11, our society has got very radicalized. And it is true that you have to tread a very thin line. If you anything perceived to be, which one sect or any sect thinks that is sacrilegious, yes, your life is in danger. And I'm afraid we have to, you know, we have to ride this difficult phase in the history of Pakistan. But the fact is, Mehdi, I'll just give you a statement. I don't want to go too deeply into all this, because it's a very difficult subject living in Pakistan. But I'll just tell you one thing. In my opinion, my party, my belief, all human beings have right. They should be protected by the state. They should be protected by the law. They should have equal rights, equal citizens. And what is happening, unfortunately, in the name of religion, is painful for all of us. Because this is not, in our opinion, most Pakistanis' opinion, this is not what Islam is.
Do you extend equal rights to Ahmadis?
All human beings have equal rights. Anyone who's a Pakistani has an equal right. The Constitution should protect him. He's an equal citizen.
Back in the day, you were captain of the Pakistani cricket team. The nation's hopes and dreams rested on your shoulders. Is it fair to say that in a sports-mad country like Pakistan, it's harder, there's more pressure being a Pakistani cricket captain than being a Pakistani political leader?
It was a very good training ground for what was to follow in Pakistani politics. Had I not had that experience of 10 years of captaincy, which is the longest tenure of anyone in our history, I wouldn't have lasted this long in politics.
Imran Khan, thanks for joining me on Upfront. The Prime Minister of the UK is now a woman. The next President of the United States will also probably be a woman. So if you're a feminist, it's time to celebrate, right? Not quite. Globally, it's not a great picture. Out of 191 world leaders, only 16 are female. At a parliamentary level, it's not much better. Over the past 20 years, the proportion of seats held by women in national parliaments across the world has, yes, doubled, but it basically went from a shameful 11% to a still pretty abysmal 22%. Women, for the record, make up half the world's population. So at a political level, waiting for gender equality to happen naturally, organically, spontaneously, doesn't seem to be working. But you know what does seem to work? Big bad quotas. Yes, positive discrimination. Take Rwanda. In 2003, the Rwandan government mandated that 30% of all representatives must be women. Today, Rwanda's lower house is 64% female, the highest proportion in the world. As Martin Luther King Jr. observed, you can't legislate to change morals, but you can legislate to change people's habits, and then over time, their attitudes and their hearts. Look at Argentina, where in 1991, a law passed insisting at least 30% of candidates running for office must be women. And today, women account for 36% of the lower house and 42% of the Senate. Compare and contrast that with many quota-free nations, including the US, which with its less than 20% female Congress, ranks a sad 96th in the world. But don't you want women there purely on the basis of their merit, say the critics of quotas? Well, hold on, the men aren't there purely on the basis of merit. They're in office, in power, because of centuries of positive discrimination in their favour. In fact, studies in the US show that women may be more effective legislators than men, sponsor more bills than men do, and deliver more funding to their districts. Above all else, more women in government, in parliament, tends to lead to less violence and less war. Okay, there are obviously exceptions to every rule. But studies have shown that as the percentage of women in parliament increases by 5%, a state is five times less likely to use violence when faced with an international crisis. So to recap, there aren't enough women in power, there's a way to get more, and if we get more, there might be more money and less war. What's not to like about that? This week in Philadelphia, Hillary Clinton officially became the Democratic nominee for President of the United States, but her party's convention was overshadowed by thousands of leaked emails from senior Democratic officials, which seemed to show a concerted effort to prevent Senator Bernie Sanders from winning the nomination. So was the race rigged? I'm joined by Professor Jeffrey Sachs of Columbia University, one of the world's best-known economists, who was an advisor to Sanders and who's called Clinton the candidate of the war machine. Jeffrey Sachs, thanks for joining me on Upfront. You supported Bernie Sanders for the Democratic presidential nomination. Given the leaked emails from the Democratic National Committee, which seemed to show the DNC actively working against Sanders and in favor of Hillary Clinton, now the nominee, do you believe Bernie Sanders was robbed?
Well, it was clear that Hillary Clinton had the inside track. She is the establishment, and the establishment won. That's not for the first time.
And do you agree with someone like Donald Trump, who says that this race was clearly rigged on the Democratic side?
I don't think rigged is exactly right. I think that Bernie Sanders was quite remarkable in what he achieved. People are very unhappy in the United States. We basically have in both parties a tremendous amount of protest. And Bernie Sanders, I thought, channeled that in a very responsible way and helped people to see what a better future could be. He came close, but he didn't make it.
During the primaries, you called Hillary Clinton not just the establishment candidate, but the candidate of the war machine, a staunch neocon with a horrible foreign policy record of failure. You called her a danger to global peace. I'm assuming, therefore, you won't be voting for her come November.
Well, the problem with elections is you have to choose one or the other. So I've said that I'm going to vote for her, but I can tell you it's if I do, in fact, it's with a lot of disappointment, because I do not support her foreign policy. I think she has been very militaristic all her career. I think her period as Secretary of State was very poor performance. Donald Trump worries the heck out of me, like he does a lot of other people. So he seems an unstable personality.
But just to clarify, will you vote for Clinton, or you haven't made up your mind?
I probably will, but if I do, it will be holding my nose because, frankly, I find the mainstream of American foreign policy of both parties really irresponsible. Both the Bush administration and the Obama administration have waged war in the Middle East for the last 15 years, and it's a complete mess. And I think that both sides have a lot of responsibility in the mess we're in.
And while both sides surely do have responsibility for the Middle East mess, surely you would accept, though, that someone like Hillary Clinton, despite her support for the Iraq war or for the Libya intervention, which you've so strongly critiqued, on a raft of international issues that are close to your heart, from climate change to international aid to gender equality, Hillary Clinton has a far, far superior record than Donald Trump's from that perspective. You can't say they're the same, can you, as some critics of Hillary Clinton say. They're not the same.
They're definitely not the same, and climate change is an example of a world-class issue, very important, where Hillary Clinton is right and Donald Trump is dangerously wrong. And so that is a good example of a very clear difference. But what has bothered me is how many interventions, how many wars Hillary Clinton has supported, from Kosovo, Afghanistan, Iraq, Syria, Libya. There's hardly been one she hasn't liked, and every one of them has been a debacle from my point of view.
Returning to domestic politics, you say you're not going to vote for Trump and you'll vote for Clinton, even though you preferred Sanders to be the presidential candidate. Are you worried that a lot of Sanders supporters aren't going to vote for Clinton? They're going to stay at home, or maybe some of them might even vote for Trump, especially after these emails, which suggest that, you know, the party was working against Sanders. There's a lot of resentment against Clinton on the Sanders side. And might they then let Trump into the White House through the back door?
It's possible, because she's not an attractive candidate, and she stands for a lot of things, this kind of corruption in politics, the alliance of the modern Democratic Party with Wall Street that her husband, President Clinton, started, that many of us don't like. This is clear. She's got a lot of baggage, and that's why I regret that she's the nominee. But, you know, again, in an election, you have to make choices.
But do you personally know of Sanders supporters who, unlike you, aren't going to vote for Clinton? Can you say, oh, wow, I've actually noticed that happening, that phenomenon?
When I tweeted a couple of weeks ago that I would vote for Clinton, boy, did I hear a lot of response, never Clinton kind of response. So,
but you would accept that never Clinton means Trump in the White House, doesn't it?
Of course, it makes it more likely. That's why I said that I would vote for Clinton, again, holding my nose.
Okay, and on Trump, what is behind the Donald Trump phenomenon, in your view, the rise of this reality TV star? There's a big debate as to whether what's driving his support is economic insecurity, white working class voters who haven't seen a rise in real income for years, or is it racial insecurity, racial anxiety, white working class voters who don't like the idea of a majority minority America, who want their country back? Which camp do you stand in when you look at the rise of Trump? Where do you think his support comes from?
I'm sure that it's both, and I'm sure that it's the same phenomenon that fueled Brexit, the same phenomenon that is fueling a lot of anti-immigrant, working-class parties all through Europe. This is not a U.S.-alone phenomenon. Each candidate has their special features, and in America, it's not surprising, in fact, that reality TV becomes reality in some bizarre way.
How much does that worry you, especially the racist aspect of it? How much does that worry you?
Well, it worries me a lot because it's extremely ugly. And there's a lot of hate. And in this country, in the United States right now, it's shocking. Police are getting shot, and young African-Americans, unarmed, are getting shot. And the two sides cannot even discuss this as one reality or as in any way holding both of those facts in place sometimes. So it's very frightening.
Jeffrey Sachs, thanks for joining me on Upfront.
Oh, thank you. Pleasure to be with you.
That's our show. Upfront will be back.